They've done it pretty well. But it's sad to feel that the first years could not be in the like hostel. They are missing a big part of that college life, isn't it, ma'am?
Yes, exactly. They are missing a big part of the college life. That's true. But still they are connected and they are enjoying, I think so.
When they will come, hopefully, like, we are also actually, because the campus is like summers or in this, almost pretty empty without, and this SN, they have revamped everything in SN and everything.
That's right. Everywhere is the same situation.
Even it doesn't look like the oldest hospital. Actually, even in the, when the students, when the summer vacation and the winter breaks are on, still the master's students are there or the PhDs are in full strength. But in our case, what happens, only the fourth years or the final year PhDs or little bit junior third years are there. So the campus is like, when you walk through the lanes, it's like nobody is there. To me, are also like missing that. Lots of things are, outlets are unopened, they have not opened. Few eateries are only opening. That nightlife, which is of IIT, that is completely.
Yeah, missing a lot, no?
So. We just want, like, before I pass out, I want this. I want to see the normal IIT life, so that at least I'll have that. Okay, this was something which was very normal.
Yes, that's right. Everybody is expecting that. Why don't you say to Vikriti sir that improve the hospital?
Actually, ma'am, this hospital nowadays are catering pretty well. But that new set of hospital which they have opened, I think they will start functioning soon. And even the SMST department has, like, they have got a very huge, beautiful, sprawling building. Earlier it was a very small, I used to work under a very small compound kind of building. But now SMST is in full power. Like, they, I think the new building, they have made it just after the professor's quarters. And it's okay. Really sprawling. It's like, I think, one of the biggest buildings any institute or any department could have. And as well as, I think, they are going to, the new this hospital is pretty much like, well functioned and equipped. I think the staffing and everything needs to be done. That's why they are not opening it.
Okay.
Otherwise, IIT, ma'am, there was lots of cases before this lockdown. Lots of students were also infected, but they pretty much handled it really well. Like the isolation centers and everything, they converted the guest house into quarantine centers and like shifting people from hostels. Actually, what is happening now, if in a hostel one single person is getting infected, the whole wing is getting tested. And out of that, if they are being tested for 4-5 people, out of them some 2-3 people are getting positive. And then they are actually doing contact tracing. So their labs are being closed, and in this way, they pretty much controlled it. But the sudden outbreak was really gruesome, but they controlled it really well. Now we don't have any active cases among students. It's like the quarantine center, whatever, they did it very well.
That's great.
In that way, we were like, okay, it's better to stay in campus than go home, because at least they are providing every facility, whatever they could do. And even for vaccination also, they had a vaccination drive, and sir got us everyone vaccinated. Like, there was some kind of a fee for vaccinated. I think our lab was the highest one who got, like, it was sponsored by sir, and everyone, like 13 people in our lab got vaccinated, including the DP which comes for cleaning. There were lab our health, their dada, and everyone got vaccinated. So that was also quite good. They did some 3,000 people they vaccinated. It was also pretty good of IIT.
Yes, that's correct. Good afternoon, sir.
Sir, you are muted.
I'm muted. Okay. Now it's fine?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Okay. How are you, Chitranga?
हाँ सर
सब अच्छा है
हाँ सब ठीक है सर
गुड वेरी गुड काफी भीड़ दिख रही है तुम्हारा लेक्चर सुनने के लिए गुड एज यूजुअल वेरी पॉपुलर
एक्चुअली दिस वेबिनार इज पॉपुलर नॉट माय टॉक
एंड स्लोली स्लोली इट इज गेटिंग
I sometimes do not get time to attend this, but always I follow up in the YouTube.
Good. So we, you know, Kaya, we your university must be good. Your
Yes, it is. No. It is still closed. Exactly like IIT, the situation is same there. But yes, administrative work is going on. Alternately, deans and other faculties are coming.
Yes.
So, at least things are moving.
We took is improve or situation. Now consider.
Yes, should be.
Jaisre, it is 5 o'clock. Would you like to wait for some time or?
No, I'm ready. I'm
sir,
ready.
Just 2 minutes. We will wait for some. Just 2 minutes. 5:03 will start it. Ma'am has already checked her here. We will just start immediately after.
Okay.
After she, just we'll wait for 2-3 minutes more and then start.
आज मिल्खा सिंह का
हां
सैड ठीक है सर का ही हैज गॉट द एज हो गया था 91 इयर्स एंड ही हैव द फुल लाइफ विद ऑनर एंड डिग्निटी
बट ही वाज रियली फिट सर मतलब लास्ट एंडिंग में भी उनके पिक्चर्स ही वाज नॉट वेरी मतलब बहुत ऐसे ये से
स्पोर्ट्स पर्सन ना स्पोर्ट्समैन तो बड़ा अभी तो इस समय 5 बजे उनका अभी है क्रिया
हाँ श्रद्धांजलि ज्ञापन उनका
और क्या कोइंसिडेंस रहा है आई थिंक 4-5 दिन पहले उनकी मिसेस डेथ हुआ
अच्छा
हाँ अभी विद इन ए वीक दोनों लोग That is again बहुत rare होता है. First she went and then he went today.
So we will start because enough people have joined and people are slowly joining.
हाँ इस speaker को बोलो video on करे कुछ देर के लिए थोड़ा सा for some time other people also should switch on the video.
Thank you.
Yes. Can we now, Ranga?
Yes, sir.
But light लगता है चेहरे के पीछे पीछे है light.
हाँ जी, वो tube light पीछे है, इसलिए थोड़ा सा problem होता है. But I am comfortable with this computer and I don't like to shift to other computer.
ठीक है, anyway, it's that,
yes. Welcome everyone. Today is our one more webinar of the webinar series, of virtual webinar series. So we are very proud to have one of the first few research scholars, PhD students, our coordinator, who Professor H.N. Mishra, who nurtured her, and she is one of the speakers today. So we cordially welcome Dr. Chitrakanta Das Mukhopadhyay. And before moving to anything, as sir have already told that today there was discussing, so on a sadder note we started, but rather on a happier note also, as it's a very proud moment for FCTL also, that our coordinator, who is the head of FCTL and have got lots of awards and accolades, but he is now ranked in one of the finest. He has been indexed in AD scientific index, and I think from IIT he is the only professor who have been indexed and got a very high rank, and it's a honor for us to be nurtured by such a great person, and a person who is so humble that he coordinates every webinar series. So I would like to congratulate sir on behalf of all FCTL members, audiences, and all the members who have listened to you. Congratulations, sir. And now, moving to our FCTL webinar, I would like to introduce Chitrangada Das Mukhopadhyay. She is Assistant Professor, Indian Institute of Engineering, Science and Technology. So today she will be speaking about gut feeling, interplay of food and mood. So before going to any further introduction about her, I would like to request sir to say a few about her, how he remembers her, how the initial stages of she doing a PhD and sir being a new professor. Sir, can you please tell a few words?
Thank you, Jayashree. So before I tell about Chitrangada, thank you for your words. And it is that yes, FCTL has got recognition in the international ranking, and I am not the only person from IIT. There are a few more also in other fields. Maybe in the department, I might be the only one. And one more, that from FCTL family, Professor Pradhuman Kumar, who is at Slide, yes. Logowal. He is working at Slide Logowal. Yes. He has also been recognized. His name is also there in that list. So it provides further strength to our family that our work, we and our people getting recognized globally. That is really a proud moment for all of us, all people who are associated with the FCTL. Now, regarding Chitrangada, as Jayashree told, that Chitrangada, perhaps she was my third PhD student who came to me. First was Shankar Sharma ji, late had Shankar Sharma, now is no more. And he was a very senior person at that time also. So somehow he was allotted to me. And then this Sadanand Patel, and after that she joined, you joined that, na? So both that Sharma ji, he was much senior to me, so he was doing in his own way, and I had not, I did not have much, but anyway, I managed with him. Professor Sadanand Patel, he was a friend of all mine when I was doing PhD. He was M.Tech here, later on he joined a project. So from that point of view, we were friends as well as later I became his PhD supervisor and he was a sponsored research fellow. So we had a very good. In fact, why I am telling the Chitrangda from that point of view that she was a real young student researcher. She was the first student from that point of view with me. Initially, Chitrangda was in the Department of Biotechnology, in fact, biotechnology, and she was working on some other project. And of course, she has been a student of Department of Biotechnology of our institute. So obviously, she was from a deep bioscience and biotech background. So later on, she was asked to work, in fact, she was associated with me for doing this her PhD research work, and I was really not very comfortable, not knowing what to do. I did not have much bio background at that time. I was just young faculty researcher joined recently in the institute. But anyway, I asked her, okay, when she came, we discussed, and after talking to her, in fact, I got motivated. I had some things in mind. I told to her, okay, I do not have a biotech, maybe plant breeding or genetic engineering biotechnology background, but I know that yes, there are certain areas of intervention where we can need, which is the need of the food industry, and with your background you can if you can work in this direction, so really it may be a good. And that was the detoxification of aflatoxin. And I gave her about 3-4 days time. She took and she, after 3-4 days, she came with a very good, wonderful plan. And then we started our journey. And in fact, research review paper she published in Critical Reviews in Food Science, that is still the highest number of citations that is having now also. No one has been able to go get more citation than her. So that is one, I'd say. And in fact, she published two papers then in food chemistry. One critical review, 3-4 papers started. In fact, it was her from, she was the source of inspiration for many researchers, that is as far as the research publication, and from her onward, the research publication, paper publication, etc., started in my lab. So from, and she was keeping not only doing research, but I still remember when came in our laboratory, the chemicals, etc., because as I told you, that time two research scholars, those who were senior to her, were very senior, even more senior to me also. So they were doing their own work, but not taking much care of the laboratory. So when she came, what she did, first thing she did, she made all the chemicals, etc., arranged in alphabetical order, and make making etc., where she did put all those chemicals, even made index of chemical store. Although those things are even being followed still. That is the thing. Okay, anyway, I will not take much time. I will say that is my memory became still fresh. Okay. So she has been one very, very excellent researcher, and let us listen to Chitrangda. She has taken a very, very important and very lively topic, that the interplay between food and mood. Yes, कहते हैं ना कि खाना कितना भी दे, whatever food you are getting, all the nutrient that is required, you can get in a capsule, but that will not fulfill your appetite. That is mood. That is emotional feeling. Unless you get the food of your choice, get the, I think let us hear Dr. Chitrangda. Yes,
thank you so much, sir. So before starting this seminar, webinar on this very lively topic, as I said, I would like to give a formal introduction to ma'am. So ma'am is, as sir has said, was one of the earliest early PhDs our Professor Mishra had, and she have done tremendously well in academics. She was a topper, gate qualified student with a very high rank, and she later she completed her, finished her PhD and joined as a postdoctoral fellow in USA in Ohio State University, and joined as assistant professor in IIST Shibpur. She had a state of art neurobiotechnology laboratory, and currently she has 4 research scholars, and one has already been awarded. And her students have developed electromagnetic devices to treat glioblastoma by creating gentle and focused hypothermia to treat Alzheimer's disease. And as well as her research interest includes development of novel therapeutics for brain tumor and Alzheimer's disease using functional genomics, bioinformatics and drug design techniques. So it's a privilege to have you here, such an eminent personality. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to start your presentation now.
Thank you so very much to Mishra sir and Jayashree and to all of the members of our FCTL family. And thank you, sir, for your kind words, even after 20 years, probably. Everything is so clear in your memory. I'm so surprised. So there is nothing really much to tell about these things, because these are memories which you cherish throughout your life. And that's why I'll tell you one thing. Just let me share. I'm showing my first introductory slide, where it is simply written Chitrangada Das Mukhopadhyay, because it's like my homecoming. So there is no further logo of any institution or anything. I roamed around at several laboratories and in India and abroad. I have presented at different scientific platforms, but this is like a cozy shelter, and I have come back as if I have come back somewhere which is my very own. And at that time I was really Chitrangada and only Chitrangada. So that's why it's without any further introduction, and it's pretty simple, only direct presentation that presented by Chitrangada Das Mukhopadhyay. All right, so I'll talk about gut feeling and interplay between food and mood. The reason of reason to choose this subject is that I'm really nowadays working in a different field, and it is there is a very faint connection now with real researches in food technology or food preservation, food storage in these areas, which nowadays is going on in this this laboratory. So I just wanted to find out some connections that where I can connect myself with the neurological background. I can connect to the food, and also I can express my I can justify my background as well, and I can contribute to the FCTL family as well. So the content of my topic is the presentation is introduction to the brain and cognition, and then I'll talk about reward system and food addiction. I'll also talk about food and cognition in particular, then brain and our diet, gut-brain axis and microbiome, and finally I'll go for conclusion and with some recommendations. Before I take a deep dive into the subject, let's take a brief tour about the human neural system. Human neural system is constituted of central neural system, that is CNS, and peripheral neural system, that is PNS. The central neural system is constituted of brain and spinal cord, and peripheral neural system that is made up of somatic neural system and autonomic neural system. Somatic neural system is mostly the voluntary one, and peripheral autonomous neural system that is mostly involuntary one, and it goes on all the time throughout your life. So this is the structure of brain, because without knowing this basic structure, we won't be able to discuss further. So in our top, in our discussion, this particular I mean mention of these particular organs of parts of brain, so will be there several times. So this is the thalamus. It relays information between cerebrum and lower region of the brain, also involved in determining pleasant and unpleasant stimuli, sleep and arousal. Then hypothalamus. This is a very important part related to mood and cognition. It controls sleep and arousal cycle, involved in anger, fear, pleasure, hunger, sexual responses, pain, blood pressure, temperature, and water balance. Then cerebrum. This is the area where sensing and consciousness, voluntary movement, emotions, all these things are, these are the center of all these emotion, I mean, activities. Corpus callosum, this is the bridge between two hemispheres of the brain. Cerebellum, this controls the controls and coordinates the muscular movement. Then the most important part is pons, pons variability. This controls the sensory and motor activities of face and head. Then medulla oblongata. Medulla oblongata controls blood pressure, breathing, and heart rate. And finally, it ends up at spinal cord, which carries information to and from the brain. So that is the overall structure of the brain. And we always say about the gray matter and white matter, but gray matter is nothing but the outer portion of the brain, where the neuron, that is the unit of brain tissue, the brain cells, functional unit of the brain. This is the neuron. The head portion of the neuron is inserted into the cortex, that is the gray matter. And the tail portion, that is the myelinated protein-rich portion, that is inserted into the medulla portion. So medulla portion is called the white matter. But brain is not only made up of only neurons. There are several fluids. About 10% of the brain is made up of cerebrospinal fluid and blood component. The cerebrospinal fluid maintains the homeostasis in a crucial, it's a most crucial function of the brain. And let me introduce a little bit about the neuronal function. So this is the body of the head of the neuron, and there are some branches which are called the dendrites, and they collect the information from other neurons, and then that pass, that is passes to the tail portion, and at the end there is a region which is called synapse. There is a synapse cleft, and there it meets with the dendrites of the other neurons. At this point, if you zoom into this small portion, then you will find that there are some bulb-like structures, bulbular structures at the end of the synapse. And neurotransmitters, they are, this portion is rich in neurotransmitters, and neurotransmitters are released to the synaptic gap, and that is again transmitted to the next dendrites. And that's how the neurotransmitters passes their information from one neuron to another. However, most of the electrical signals are passed from the neuron in some other electrochemical methods. So there is another very important component, which is called blood-brain barrier. This barrier is so important for the brain structure and transmission of several molecules, because this is the structure which is a selective permeable membrane, and that allows passive and active insertion of the macromolecules, and like glucose, amino acids, these are passed through it. They are very selective about some of the drugs. They don't allow everything to pass through this membrane to the brain. So in normal cases, this is the normal blood capillary. And this is the blood capillary in the brain. So this is the outer portion these are the endothelial cells. This blue portion is the endothelial cells. You just see that in normal blood capillary, there are some intercellular spaces, but in brain capillary, this is covered by tight junction. So it is almost closed. They don't allow everything to go in as well as important things to go out. And this, again, in turn, is covered by some other type of brain cells, which are called astrocytes. And there are pericytes also, which are embedded within this astrocyte region. And there is a very strong basal membrane that is the structure of the blood-brain barrier. So their function is, the main function of blood-brain barrier is protection, then homeostasis, and defensive barrier against pathogen and toxin. And as I mentioned earlier, it is selective permeable membrane, so it can categorize drugs and other relevant molecules and selectively give them permission to enter the brain. Now, what is a cognition? We very commonly use this term, and we will be also using throughout our discussion. So it's a mental action or process of acquiring knowledge and understanding through thought, experience, and the senses. It is responsible basically for all intellectual functions, computational functions, decision making, problem solving, evaluation, judgment, reasoning, knowledge, attention, perception, and everything. And it is the main reason of it also functions to save the memories, and it can be of two types. Memory processing may be of, again, two types. One is short-term and another is long-term memory. So only a single portion in the brain that cannot perform all these functions. So there are different areas on the brain which coordinate and helps to improve the cognition process. Any dysfunction of this particular, any of this area may lead to cognitive impairment. Now, let's talk about brain metabolism and energy. Very common questions may come into our mind that how does the food we eat affect our body and our brain? How do our emotions and our thoughts influence our food intake? How does the brain work? How are gut microbiome and the brain related? So I'll come to all of these answers eventually throughout our discussion. Some very fun fact is that the energy consumed by 1 gram of brain during a minute of an average day is the same as a gram of leg muscle when we are running or going for a marathon. Brain metabolism doesn't slow down ever. When even we are sleeping or during anesthesia or during coma, isn't it surprising how it happens? Brain stores only 1/100th of glycogen of what a liver weighing the same would do. So, to function properly, it needs a constant supply of nutrients such as glucose, because that is the simplest form of food which will release the energy. That's why brain has to always communicate to the digestive system, that is commonly called gut. It is therefore no surprise that there is a specific communication pathway between the brain and the gut called the gut-brain axis. Now defining my topic, initial portion of my topic, gut feeling. Physiologically, gut feelings is a combination of your gut bacteria communicating directly to your brain via chemical messengers in the blood, cytokine transmission, or even through neurotransmitters, and the gut neurons connection to the limbic, that is emotional and intuitive part of the brain. We will talk about this mesolimbic pathway. From spiritual point of view, gut feeling is an intuition. When people usually get an overall sensation of knowing the thing, premonition, which you can say. So brain has a steering, is the steering center of the body. That's why it's brain, right? So gut brain axis, what is it? It is composed of several subunits, and it's a very complex, extremely complex system, and influence almost all the bodily functions. It influences motility. Even before we take a bite of the food, it can instruct the stomach to release gastric juices. However, this is a bidirectional process. Gut bacteria can also help in neurotransmission through different pathways, and it can also control mood and behavior, appetite, food intake, and vice versa. That means brain also can influence the gut health. So gut-brain axis mainly is constituted of HPA axis, autonomic nervous system, immune system, vagus nerve, and gut microbiota. We will focus mostly on HPA axis, vagus nerve, and gut microbiota. So HPA axis, what is it? It's a neuroendocrine system comprised of hypothalamus, pituitary, and adrenal glands. All right, so it is a neuroendocrine system. It means hypothalamus, the brain part, it is connected to the pituitary gland and to the adrenal gland. Body's primary stress response system, coordinating and also regulating digestion, immune system, energy utilization, and all these functions. So first, hypothalamus in stressed condition releases corticotropin hormone that induces ACTH release from pituitary, and finally cortisols are released from adrenal glands. If cortisol is high, then hypothalamus lowers down CRH release, and output to reduce levels of ACTH and cortisol. So in stressed condition, more cortisols are released, and in normal condition, it is in equilibrium, it is in balanced state. If sometimes this hypothalamus pituitary also involves thyroid gland, then we call it HPT axis. So basically, immune system, blood pressure, growth, metabolic rate, eating, drinking, behavior, stress response, mood and emotions, energy utilization, everything is connected and regulated to HPA axis or HPT axis. What will happen if HPA axis starts dysfunctioning? The symptoms you should follow, that chronic fatigue, frequent yawning. This may be a sign that nervous system is trying to reset itself. Brain fog, excessive appetite, poor sleep, poor athletic performance or physical endurance, low mood or depression. Then physiological effects of HPA axis function, that is a bottoming out of cortisol and other steroid hormones such as estrogen, progesterone, DHEA, and testosterone. Alterations in the gut microbiota, increased intestinal permeability, cognitive dysfunction, slowed metabolism, and immune dysfunction. So the clinical consequences of HPA is obesity, diabetes mellitus, type 2, and cardiovascular diseases. Emotional stress, the main reason of obesity development in humans. stress also induces different eating disorders like anorexia. HPA axis and its associated molecules like glucocorticoids, adrenocorticotropin, corticotropin releasing hormone, all these regulate food intake under stressed condition. There are not much treatment option, therapeutic options for HPA dysfunction. What we can do that we can alter the food habit. For that, some people actually get rid of carbohydrate containing food. So they generally are affected with HPA dysfunction. So we have to start carbon backloading so that it is the eating strategy in which you eat the majority of your carbohydrates with your evening meal rather than spread throughout the day. Maintain a consistent meal time. Intermittent fasting, especially in women, can initiate symptoms of HPA axis dysfunction. High protein to maintain blood sugar level and fermented food should be taken to maintain the gut microbiome composition. Now, cognition, the science of mind, a little more in detail. The mind is a very complex and yet unexplored phenomenon or structure. Cognition includes a visual perception, object recognition, and attention as a way to learn about the world. It looks into the acquisition and retrieval of memories, problem solving, and other intelligence task skills. What does cognition has to do with our food habit? It's really turns out to be a lot. The availability of neuroimaging tools nowadays like fMRI or PET or EEG can even watch what is happening in your brain, that is in your mind, during certain mental tasks. Our cognitive skills are influenced by certain diets or nutrients, such as omega-3 fatty acids and antioxidants. Eating is actually a behavior, and the relationship between cognition and eating behavior is again bidirectional. So cognition can control mood and food, as well as food can control, again, mood. Let me introduce a new term, that is food reward responses. Whenever you perform something very good, you expect some reward. So that expectation, that is urge for getting some reward, is called the reward response. It is the same in case of the brain as well. The reward system is a group of neural structures in the brain responsible for certain desire or craving for a reward. A rewarding stimulus, maybe any stimulus, any object, event, activity, or situation that has the potential to make us approach and consume it, is by definition a reward. So suppose you are thinking to have a very nice meal, a palatable meal. So that is one your desire. But when you are getting that food, that is the reward. It's an adaptive function. So you just try to adapt with the situation. If it is extremely sunny, you are standing outside and it's very scorchy, then you want to go to the shadow. So that's an adaptive function, behavioral adaptation. And you want to relate certain situations with pleasure and helps to adapt and survive. There are many other functions, that is, suppose somebody is very thirsty and want to drink some water. So when you are drinking the water, that is the food reward response, due to the food reward response in the brain. The main neurotransmitter involved in the reward response process is dopamine. And they allow the circuit to activate. A weightage or value is assigned to the stimulus, to the reward. So when we are talking about science, we cannot just mention anything which is abstract. So we will always try to talk quantitative rather than qualitative. So we like to assign a weightage value. Studies showed that extreme sweetness or high calorie food can be more rewarding than even cocaine. Now, brain areas responsible for the reward responses. Many brain areas are involved in the reward process. Actually, all these processes are highly orchestrated. Not a single area can perform a complete job. So many brain areas are involved in this process, and they are distributed in different areas and connected to each other and forms the circuit, which is called mesocorticolimbic circuit. This circuit, which is involved in the brain reward response, this is called mesocorticolimbic circuit. Areas involved in reward responses are ventral tegmental area, that is VTA, ventral tegmental area, VTA, the nucleus accumbens, that pleasure control center of the brain, hypothalamus and hippocampus area, amygdala, frontal cortex, globus pallidus, pituitary gland. Integration of different signals, that is stimuli, like smell, sight, taste, hunger, all these things happens in areas that are linked to higher cognitive functions. So this is here, which I'm showing two different pathways, dopamine and serotonin pathway. Dopamine, both of them are two different neurotransmitters. They are basically the happy neurotransmitters. So dopamine is synthesized and starts its transmission from VTA region. The yellow portion is the dopamine pathway. So it reaches to the frontal cortex, and nucleus accumbens that also join to this journey, and serotonin that starts its journey from raphe nucleus and hippocampal region. It reaches to all the part of the cortical region of the brain, including substantia and the dopamine pathway involves substantia nigra and striatum. What is its function? It functions for reward, pleasure, euphoria, motor function, compulsion, perseverance. And serotonin functions for mood, memory processing, sleep, and cognition. There is a negative reward system as well. See, after a large meal, you lack the desire to get more food, right? Such fine tuning of liking and desires cannot be generated by the solitary activity of one or two brain areas, but instead the result of a complex interaction and feedback loop. So when you stop eating, and the negative reward system is activated, that is done by feedback loop. So this is a picture where the brain is thinking of different food, but due to negative reward system, it's not getting any food out of that. Food addiction. This is a very interesting term. This term was introduced no more than 10 years back. We know about addictions. Addictions are the negative part of the wonderful adaptation mechanism, that is reward mechanism. Many studies have shown that cocaine, among other substances, also activate this circuit, food addiction circuit. This may be the risk of brain's reward system. Not only cocaine, commonly whatever we call as a drug addiction, that actually is a modification of food addiction, and that is the extreme case of food addiction. And from there, even if you want to quit, you cannot do so very easily. Taking some pills, like regularly, some people, they also, for their treatment, initially they start taking some pills, but later they are also addicted to those pills. So food addiction shares some similarities with other addictions as well, such as cravings, denying the problem, and unsuccessful attempts to quit. Result of food addiction, obviously obesity. Chronic overeating causes obesity. Overweight means being overweight or fat is having more body fat than is optimally healthy. It causes diabetes. Blood glucose or blood sugar levels are too high. Type 2 diabetes results from insufficient production of insulin, causing high blood sugar, heart disease, high blood pressure. High pressure in the arteries, that is vessels that carry blood from the heart to the rest of the body, is caused due to obesity. Then childhood obesity, it's a condition in which a child has a weight which is above the normal levels for their age and height. Then Prader-Willi syndrome, it is a genetic disorder affecting many body parts and the growth. From the clinical point of view, we can say that food addiction leads to many eating disorders. Psychological and mental disorders are the consequences of multiple factors, maybe genetic or maybe biologic. Life events like upbringing, family life, social relationship, all these things may have a strong impact on food addiction. People suffering from eating disorders try to avoid binges, that is overeating, but lacks sufficient motivation to do that. This also causes self-restricting behaviors and an increased vulnerability of uncontrolled episodes, that is leading to restricting and relapsing cycles of eating. Uncontrolled eating episodes are often a way to cope up with extreme emotions, but this may not be always connected to food addiction. So, how do you understand neurobiologically that you have this eating disorder or you are addicted to food? Neurobiological measures include studies of some animal models. Scientists have proved that regular intake of high protein or sugar containing food increases secretion of neurotransmitters in reward area. Similar studies unequivocally pointing out elevated levels of this protein in the human proves traits of food addiction. Neuroimaging techniques also shows the evidence of neurobiological reward system. And there is a food addiction scale, which is called the Yale Food Addiction Scale, that is used by the psychologists. It exhibits markers of substance dependence with the consumption of high fat or high sugar foods. There are a pool of questions which you need to answer to measure with this Yale Food Addiction Scale. The scale questions fall under specific criteria and symptoms for substance dependence as stated in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. A clinical validation of the instrument has also been conducted earlier by different scientists as well. Now, food and emotion. Can emotions change our eating behavior? If so, then how? Can food we eat change our emotions? If so, then how? Do we eat differently when I'm happy or sad or angry? We generally don't think about these things, but there are several ways how it can be coordinated. Emotional control of food choice. There are five actually main way how emotion and food is connected. Emotional control of food choice, emotional suppression of food intake, impairment of cognitive eating controls, eating to regulate emotions, emotion congruent modulation of eating. So emotion controlling food, let us go for some case studies. Tasting a palatable food evoke a positive response and promotes further intake. Tasting something bitter or rotten evokes a negative response that leads to the termination of food intake. This describes emotions aroused by food stimuli affecting food choice. Neophobia. The fear of trying new and unknown food is an example of a food-induced emotional response causing emotional suppression of food intake. Some more case studies, emotion controlling food. Intense emotion suppress intake. Intense fear may be associated with autonomic nervous system responses exhibiting the motivation to eat, inhibiting the motivation to eat. Glucose absorption is delayed and activity in the gastrointestinal tract is also inhibited. Deep sadness causes most people to withdraw from the environment, including the interest in food. The negative and positive emotions that can impair our cognitive eating control mechanism. People showing dietary restraint appear to be less likely to control their eating behavior while being emotional. I'll talk about people dietary restraint. They actually remain in a very controlled diet, stringent controlled diet. So they are actually not much affected with the emotion. Some food intake during negative emotions make it less negative. If you are very sad and eat a lot of palatable food, then can immediately improve your mood, which speaks for an immediate hedonistic mechanism or a distraction from the mood as pathway to the mood changes. Ingestion of food causes neurochemical response like release of serotonin or an endocrine response. The last category is actually a byproduct of emotional activation. So sadness has been found to decrease and joy has been found to increase the pleasantness and motivation to eat. When you are happy and content, you are more open to the environment, to the offered food, and even you would like to try new food experiences, which in turn increases your mood even further and vice versa. Now, how food modulates the emotion? This is the taste atlas. Okay, so every region has their own food, very special of their own, very special of their own country. Like India has biryani. Prior experiences impact food choices and follow for the rest of your life. Even if one migrates elsewhere, never forget those foods due to a certain emotional attachment. Parental and cultural upbringing leads the decision for a suitable meal for breakfast, lunch, or dinner. Although people adapt to the eating habits and choices of the new country, but tendency to bear traditions of food habit and even hand them over to the children is very common. A reservation for the way of making food based on past experiences, knowledge, and attitudes shapes our eating behavior and our food choices and amount of food intake. A prior mindset about genetically modified products or additives may influence food choice and eating behavior both positively and negatively. So here are some homemade dumplings in China. This is the symbol of genetically modified food, which are made biotechnologically, but nowadays people say no to them. And this is the style, homemade style of making food, which we prefer even if we are far away from our home. So now I will say a few things about eating disorders. How can you know that you have eating disorder or not? Do you care more about the virtue of what you eat than the pleasure you receive from eating it? Do you only enjoy eating foods considered healthy? Does your diet socially isolate you? Does your diet make it difficult for you to eat anywhere but at home, distancing you from family and friends? Do you feel guilt or self-loathing when you stray from your diet? Do your thoughts constantly revolve around healthy nutrition? do you organize your diet around your day around your diet? If yes, then you are actually in the early stage of eating disorders. There can be different types of eating disorders. Anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, binging eating disorders, rumination, restrictive food intake, orthorexia nervosa, etc. Treatment for disruptive and abnormal eating behavior is not there much. A combination of cognitive behavioral therapy, psychoeducation, anti-anxiety and antidepressant medications are the only way probably for treating eating disorders. What are the symptoms of eating disorders? Skipping meals or making excuses for not eating, adopting an overly restrictive vegetarian diet, excessive focus on healthy eating and excessive exercise, making own meal rather than eating what the family eats, withdrawing from normal social activities, persistent worry or complaining about being fat and talk of losing weight, frequent checking in the mirror for perceived flaws, repeatedly eating large amount of sweets or high fat foods in secret, use of dietary supplements, laxatives, or herbal products for weight loss, calluses on the knuckles from inducing vomiting. Some people actually eat and then just from their guilt feeling and to maintain their body weight, they just vomit the food they have taken. So the calluses occurs in the knuckles. Problems with loss of tooth enamel, that may be a sign of repeated vomiting. Leaving during meals to use the toilet, eating much more food in a meal or snack than is considered normal, expressing depression, disgust, shame, or guilt about eating habits. So all these are symptoms of eating disorders. So this is a case of anorexia nervosa, a potentially life-threatening eating disorder characterized by an abnormally low body weight, intense fear of gaining weight, and a distorted perception of weight or shape. Use extreme efforts to control their weight and shape. Do too much of exercise. Binge eating disorders, tendency to eat too much food, and no control over eating. Very fast eating and eat more food than intended, even when one is not hungry, and may continue eating even long after you are uncomfortably full. After a binge, they don't try to compensate for this behavior. Rather, neither they do excessive exercise or purging. Embarrassment can lead to secret eating to hide your bingeing habit. People may be normal weight or overweight or obese, those who are having the binge eating disorders. The third one, this is rumination. This is a childhood habit. Repeatedly and persistently, they regurgitate food after eating, and food is brought back up into the mouth without nausea or gagging. And regurgitation may not be intentional or due to medical reasons. They just do so. Bulimia nervosa. This is very common eating disorder. A serious life-threatening eating disorder, alternate episodes of bingeing and purging, lack of control on eating, typically eat a large amount of food in a short time and then try to read off the extra calories in an unhealthy way. That's the signature of bulimia nervosa, that they want to eat to get rid of extra calories in an unhealthy way. Forced vomiting, or too much exercise or use of laxatives to get rid of the calories because of guilt, shame, and an intense fear of weight gain from overeating. Restrictive food intake. Failing to meet minimum daily nutrition requirements due to lack of an interest in eating. Avoid food with certain sensory characteristics such as color, texture, smell, taste. Too much concerned about the consequences of eating, such as fear of choking. Food is not avoided because of fear of gaining weight in this case. Now, this is a very common symptom. Don't like vegetables. It may be your genes who is responsible for this feature. Certain genes may mean that vegetables taste more bitter for some people. The taste gene can affect how people perceive different flavors. Taste bud sensitivity decreases as we age. So even your most disliked vegetables could become palatable in later life. Now, the taste gene, which is called TAS2R38, if this is dominant, then you express the repulsion of the towards the vegetable. But if it is recessive, then you are normal. So you are no more sensitive. Since fruits and vegetables contain numerous phytonutrients and essential nutrients that can reduce inflammation and oxidative damage, two key damaging processes linked to cardiovascular disease, cancer, diabetes, and other chronic diseases. It is useful for individuals to try to understand their own preferences, and when unhealthy, they should use their cognitive function to override some of these disorders. So in normal condition, when you are under stress, then then normal food restriction from dieting and advantageous genetic environmental traits, they induce the brain and neural compensation occurs to prevent alteration of dopamine ventral striatal reward system. No binding of self-starvation and associated cues with motivation value. So this is a normal eating pattern. But in abnormal eating situation, if you do not eat under stress, then severity of food restriction, at-risk genetic environmental traits, in these cases, you won't eat the food even when you are stressed. And in that situation, alteration of dopamine ventral striatal reward system occurs. And binding of self-starvation and associated cues with motivational value happens, and perpetuation of not eating cycle goes on. Why to categorize good and bad food? Today's society try to find perfect lifestyle and the perfect diet. So this is a societal urge. They remove gluten, lactose, carbohydrates, and many more things. We are taught to believe that certain diets can make us happy and life better. Organic stores worldwide are spreading, and people are becoming more interested and educated about foods free of engineered ingredients or chemical pesticides. People also search for diets that can fight disease and promote longevity. Books are also promising for happy hormones and a slim belly, or a diet that will heal whatever you are suffering from and finding inner peace in the process. People with orthorexia nervosa develops a set of subjective dietary rules, ingredients, or procedures. This cognitive setup and the high need for cognitive control is difficult to open up, and the treatment process becomes very difficult. So to conclude, we can say that it is okay to have a choice, but not too extreme that can cause pathological disorder, and better not to follow any myths without scientific basis. Now, food and the essential fatty acid and the brain health. These are mostly the polyunsaturated fatty acids, so which are beneficial to our health, and they help to reduce the risk of stroke and cardiovascular events. There are mostly they are omega-3 fatty acids, except the linoleic acid. Mostly all other are the omega-3 fatty acid, and they have a lot of health benefits. Simplest form of omega-3 fatty acid is the alpha-linolenic acid, and They are available in flax seeds, flax oil, pumpkin seeds, walnuts, etc. Some reduces inflammation, like eicosapenta, inoic acid. These are the complex omega-3 fatty acid with 5 double bond, and mainly obtained from animal sources, that is fish oil, with few plant sources. But docosahexaenoic acid, that is omega-3 with 6 double bonds, these improves the nervous function, and they are never obtained from plant sources and can be obtained only from animal sources, that is fish oil. So these are the very important omega-3 fatty acids which we should always go for. Time for an oil change. Omega-3 fatty acids bring balance to our hormones, reduce inflammation, regulate our blood sugar, prevent blood clotting, keep our cholesterol and triglycerides in balance, relax our blood vessels, and make our cells healthy and resilient. So these are the different sources of beautiful fatty acids, which are essential for our survival. How do they impact our brain? The membranes of the neurons contain high concentration of DHA and play a very important role to transmission of electrical pulse and overall brain functioning. Low DHA levels can result in cognitive impairments such as learning and developmental deficiencies. DHA is also very important for our vision. The retina contains very high level of DHA, and studies showed that low DHA levels during the first years of life can lead to lifelong vision deficits. Can omega-3s prevent and cure neurological or psychological conditions? Actually, omega-3 cannot cure as such. They can prevent or they can delay the onset. Omega-3s prevents depression, vascular dementia, stroke, schizophrenia, cardiovascular diseases by inhibiting the buildup of fatty depositions. The omega-3, especially DHA, can slow cognitive decline, as just mentioned, and prevents the dementias like Alzheimer's. A meta-analysis done in 2018 reported that omega-3 supplementation can improve the symptoms of depression. Fish oil formulations that contain more EPA than DHA and not the vice versa is useful. So always you should check the level that is EPA is more than DHA or not. Now the most important thing, that is antioxidants. Antioxidants have a great role in our brain, as you know that brain has a high degree of oxygen utilization rate, and thus it has a high level of unsaturated fatty acids in their cell membrane. And thus, they have a very weak mechanisms for antioxidant defense mechanism. So excessive accumulation of reactive oxygen species or the free radicals and lipid peroxidation products in the brain may lead to the neurodegenerative diseases like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease. What happens with the free radicals? Biologically speaking, these free radicals, they lack electrons. As much as they need, they don't have that much electrons, and thus they try to steal it from any other molecule. It may be lipid, it may be DNA, it may be say enzymes or proteins. So if it scavenges it from if it steals from lipids, then a chain of reaction starts and the cell may go to death. If it is causing DNA damage, the free radicals, I'm talking about free radicals, if they cause any DNA damage, then mutations or cancer may happen. If they are stealing it from any enzymes or other proteins, then cell aging, senescence may occur. So the antioxidants, they can scavenge these free radicals naturally. So that's why we have to get more and more antioxidants so that we can save our brain. Flavonoids are a very common class of antioxidants consumed through our diet. But not all the flavonoids can cross blood-brain barrier or the CSF barrier to reach the brain cells. Quercetin found in onions, soy isoflavones, and some other metabolites of them may pass through these fluid barriers. Antioxidants can prevent oxidative stress to brain cells and protects the adult brain, which virtually stops replacing dead or dying neurons. As you know, the neurons cannot divide. So once any neuron is damaged or starts dysfunctioning in the brain, there is no further way to replace it. So antioxidants may help to protect them. Long-term consumption of flavonoids increases neuroplasticity, decreases blood pressure. Now I will talk about the most important thing, that is gut-brain axis, which is the center of our discussion today. And vagus nerve is the main player maintaining the gut-brain axis and several body functions intact and in equilibrium. Vagus nerve is the longest nerve, and this nerve starts from the medulla oblongata and reaches to all the major internal organs. Like, it reaches to the heart through cardiac plexus and lungs through pulmonary plexus, and then through esophagus it continues all the way down to several, touching different visceral organs to the colon. The vagus nerve is the part of parasympathetic nervous system, and it carries information from the inner organs to the brain, giving it feedback on the state of the body. This nerve is one of the pathways through which the microbiota in the gut, they can affect the brain. The vagus nerve can sense the metabolic products of the gut microbiome, and that is the status of the microbiome composition, and inform that to the brain. And brain in turn sends, like transmits, anti-inflammatory signals through which the brain can directly influence the composition of our gut microbiota. There are five simple ways to deal with stress and inflammation using the power of vagus nerve. How to do that? As you have seen that vagus nerve starts from the brain and ends up to the colon and touches almost all the visceral organs. Naturally, if the vagus nerve is undisturbed, unfolded, and unrestricted, in that case, the body will function much more smoother. So diaphragmatic breathing and thoracic mobility, improving posture and neck mobility, eliciting positive emotions, exercise and yoga, chanting like humming songs or some other rhymes, all these things have some good effect. You always, after doing these things like yoga and say after a brisk walk, you always have a feel good effect. So that is a simple way how you can nourish the vagus nerve and keep your health perfect. But when your vagus nerve is not in proper action, then you have to stimulate the vagus nerve. And how can you do that? By increasing the vagal tone. What is that? Response of the vagus nerve is measured by a parameter which is called vagal tone. Increased vagal tone activates parasympathetic nervous system and allows the body to recover faster from the stress. So vagus nerve is the mind-body connection. Increased vagal tone secretes more norepinephrine, increasing memory, more acetylcholine for better respiration and sleep. Vagal dysfunction can lead to various digestive disorders like inflammation, poor gut microbiota. Sometimes probiotics improve vagal tone, stimulating the vagus nerve function in the brain through relaxation techniques deep breathing or meditation, all these things help in vagus nerve health. There is another point, short chain fatty acid. They also contributes to maintain the gut-brain axis health, homeostasis. Another communication pathway that connects the gut microbiome and the brain is formed by short chain fatty acids. They are produced by the bacteria when metabolizing the carbohydrates that were not able to be digested. So undigested carbohydrates are converted by these gut microbiota to the short chain fatty acid. A part of the short chain fatty acid is absorbed into the bloodstream and can reach to the brain, passing the blood-brain barrier with the help of monocarboxylate transporters in the brain. SCFA can bind to specific receptors and activate the hypothalamus that regulates metabolism and promotes the synthesis of serotonin. Again, serotonin, it's a major neurotransmitter and happy neurotransmitter. Hormonal signaling pathway is the third channel of connecting the brain and the gut and made up of several hormonal signaling pathway. Some hormones that are produced by the digestive system can influence our feeding behavior as well. Production of these hormones can be modulated by the amount of SCFAs circulating in our body. They also can modulate the level of insulin, ghrelin, leptin, these hormones, and have an effect on our metabolism as well as our mood and cognition. So these are the good foods which helps to increase our hormonal signals, keep our hormonal signaling pathway healthy. Coming to the last point, that is gut microbiome. Our digestive system, that is the intestinal system, even actually starting from the mouth itself, have a pool of microbes, and they can modulate a wide range of symptoms. Like they can impart its effect through HPA stress response, immune response, neurotransmission, tryptophan metabolism, and serotonin synthesis. All processes which are highly relevant to the regulation of mood and cognition. Changes in diet can rapidly and reproducibly alter microbiome composition. Even if you are taking too much of antibiotics, then also your gut microbiome may be altered. The gut microbiome represents the link in the observed association between food and mood, direct link between food and mood. Diet is a major determinant of microbiota diversity. Studies reported that altered gut microbiota composition in patients with depression. What are the bacteria live in our gut? There are good bacteria and there are bad bacteria. Good bacteria includes bifidobacteria, E. coli, lactobacilli, mostly lactobacilli. And bad bacteria, these are pathogenic in nature. They are Campylobacter, Enterococcus, Fecalis, Clostridium, Difficile. Then the most severe one is Helicobacter pylori. It can even cause cancer. The stomach environment is highly acidic. pH is only 2. Despite of that, it hosts a large community of different bacteria. Gut microbiota is not static. So it's a dynamic system. In presence of different types of food, it can change its composition, and diversity increases as we go down the lane, that is towards the colon. Diversity is much more. Here is a here you can get an idea that in the stomach it is only 10 to the power 2 to 10 to the power 3 in number, and only the lactobacilli is there. In the duodenum also only the lactobacilli predominates. Then streptococci and lactobacillus is there in jejunum, but as you go down to ileum and colon, then Enterobacter, Enterococcus, Fecalis, Bacteroidetes, and Peptos, Ruminococcus, Clostridia, Lactobacilli, these things increases. There are two largest phyla making up the gut microbiome in humans. Those are Firmicutes and Bacteroidetes. They have several subclasses under them. However, in general, these Firmicutes to Bacteroidetes ratio, that is F by B ratio, is very important. And they can predict several pathological conditions. So once you can test the bacterial composition in any laboratory, you can understand that you are healthy or if you are having any underlying problem. Why the microbiome is so vital in your health? It is so because it is called the guardians of the brain. Brain can modulate gut microbiome through the control of food habit. These control mechanisms are not linear. It's circular, closed loop, in which both the gut and the brain receive and send signals to the main metabolic balance to maintain the metabolic balance and equilibrium of the body. The bacteria most often involved are lactobacilli, that I have just shown in previous slide. And brain regulates the microbiota by anti-inflammatory activity of the vagus nerve, peristalsis in the stomach, regulating the levels of stress hormones through the hypothalamic pituitary axis. Our mind and our brain can and should defend a healthy microbiota and enjoy the benefits of healthy gut-brain axis. So here are some effects of if the microflora is affected. So harmful effects include obesity, inflammation, autism, and beneficial effects include immunity, vitamin synthesis, especially vitamin B and K, and right metabolism, proper metabolism. The composition of gut microbiome of normal and obese people are different. So I'm not going into detail of this one because, So can the brain modify our microbiota? Yes, it can. As I have just said, that it is a cyclic process. So brain releases neurotransmitters, mainly serotonin and dopamine, and they control the neuromuscular functions and peristalsis and all other autonomous nervous system functions, and induces flight or fight and stress response, that is, they releases cortisols and secretion of mucus occurs, and then that in turn controls the composition of the microbial diversity in the gut microbiome, and gut microbiome in turn imparts its effect to the brain through vagus nerve activation, neuropeptides and neurotransmitters like leptin and serotonin, immune signaling, barrier integrity signaling like zonulin, and short-chain fatty acid like butyrates. In conclusion, I'd like to say that during the total presentation, we have discussed about the relationship between food, body, and brain from multiple points of view. Following the introductory part, we have discussed about food reward responses, food addiction, the negative addiction as well, and their regulation. We continued our discussion about different psychological topics, connecting food intake and cognition, emotion, mood, etc. We discussed about different food disorders and also the consequences of restrained eating habit, and then again went back to discuss about certain good and bad molecules for brain and health, like antioxidants and all. And actually we understood at the end that multiple communication channels remain between gut and the brain. That means food, mood, and brain, these are all interconnected. So this connection is maintained through HPA axis, vagus nerve, gut microbiome. Gut feelings are a certain pattern recognition system that is designed to keep you safe and well. About 90% of the serotonin receptors are located in the gut, and antidepressants like SSRI leads to gastrointestinal problems. There is a two-way communication, anatomical and physiological, between the gut and the brain via the vagus nerve. Balance between good and bad bacteria should be in equilibrium. The gut-brain axis links diet and disease, including depression and anxiety. However, food is not the only treatment for mood. And when we talk about mood problems, actually we are referring to mild and moderate forms of depression and anxiety. For serious forms of depression and thoughts of suicide, it is important to seek medical intervention. Always eat whole foods and avoid packaged and processed food, which are high in unwanted food additives and preservatives. Instead of vegetables or fruit juices, consider increasing your intake of fresh foods and vegetables. Frozen foods also can be taken. Eat enough fiber and include whole grains and legumes in your diet. Include probiotic rich food. Adding fermented food like kefir, sauerkraut and kimchi may be helpful. Eat a balance of seafood and lean poultry and less red meat each week. Add a range of colorful fresh fruits and vegetables to your diet and consider choosing certain organic produce. So these are the good foods which you should take. This is the salmon, and these definitely you should avoid. At the end, the most interesting part is that this seems to reiterate that it is told, what is told in the Indian text Bhagavad Gita a few millennia ago. There were three verses especially related to food taken in. The foods which promote life, strength, health, joy, cheerfulness. Those are sweet, soft, nourishing, and agreeable, are dear to the good. The foods that are bitter, sour, saltish, very hot, pungent, harsh, burning, producing pain, grief, and disease are liked by passionate. The foods which are spoiled, tasteless, putrid, stale, refuse, and unclean is the food dear to the dull. So one cannot think well, love well, sleep well, if one has not dined well. So go for good eating. Many more mysteries are yet to unfold. This is the a map of nerve fibers of human brain. It was constructed using a special MRI scanning technique called diffusion weighted imaging, DWI, that traces the direction of water flow. Water diffuses along the fatty sheets around the nerve fiber rather than through them. Rather than through the neurons, they passes through the nerve fibers. So tracing water flow in the brain reveals the complex network of fibers. This image represents only a small portion of the neural connections in the brain. There are hundreds and billions of neurons in the human brain and trillions of connections between them. Such complexity is why the brain has remained largely a mystery even after decades of research. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Chitra Gandha Madam. I think this was one of the most, the topic was from itself, it was interesting. I think one of the most detailed and one of something unforeseen topic which has not been till webinar. I think, and everyone listened, such detail, like you covered every aspect and lots of new things we came to know which were like myths and something which I follow, and I realized that they were like somewhat not very correct. But I never thought that why we crave for so much sweet or the cognitive function regarding to food. I think that was one of the best seminars we had till date. I think the audience would also agree. Thank you so much, ma'am. I would love to hear you again. It was a pleasure to hear.
Thank you so much.
It was just amazing. I think everyone was glued till their chair. So obviously that's a very detailed presentation, and I think many of you will have questions. So people can unmute them and ask questions at the desire, or they can write in the chat box. We will take the questions accordingly. Ma'am, you stopped the presentation.
Yeah, I did so. Actually, it's a although it's a everyday life story which I just told you, but all of us probably knowingly or unknowingly follow certain of the certain food habits or certain restrictions, and we prefer to remain healthy. But actually, how we can remain healthy, that I wanted to discuss through my presentation.
So true. I never knew that someone not liking vegetables is actually a gene is involved. We always thought that the kid was not raised properly. Sir, you are on mute. You want to say something?
Mishra, sir? Yes, sir. I am looking forward to some queries from the audience. Wonderful presentation. Like, although so many things went out of my head, little deep science and medical biology. But anyway, it was very, very interesting.
Thank you, sir.
Day to day, हाँ जो सही कहा कि मतलब हमारे daily life से बहुत कुछ मतलब which we should follow. के जो अभी देखा कि आई हैव नाउ क्या लिखा है डाइट का क्या बताया था यू टोल्ड अस सम ईटिंग डिसऑर्डर सिम्पटम्स ऑफ ईटिंग डिसऑर्डर
यस
दैट इटसेल्फ इन फैक्ट इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड मेनी आप उसको अगर देखो तो लगता है सब लोग इस रोग से पीड़ित है ईटिंग डिसऑर्डर हां
वो
वी आर ऑल फूड साइंटिस्ट एंड द मेडिकल डॉक्टर्स इफ यू कंट्रोल योर डाइट डिजीज विल नेवर टच यू पर्टिकुलरली इफ यू टेक द प्रॉपर डाइट एट प्रॉपर टाइम इन प्रॉपर अमाउंट इन प्रॉपर मैनर तो कोई भी आपको बीमारी कभी होगी नहीं और अगर होती भी है तो वो उसको भी डाइट से आप कंट्रोल कर सकते हो डाइट डाइट एंड हेल्थ दे आर क्वाइट रिलेटेड टू ईच अदर यस गुड
Yes. Yes. You can from the aroma itself you can just say that what is the composition or something, but you know as a scientist we always look for that. I just mentioned we always have to go for quantitative analysis, so you have to do sensory analysis. There's no other way. You cannot escape the experiments. You have to do that. Yes, so sensory analysis is the only way how you can actually do those.
Ma'am, I also have a question, like when companies do that consumer survey or they they go for a major number of people. So, how much that the cultural, socio-cultural, or the impact of their what you call older eating habits impact that kind of sensory analysis when like for a nation or a, like they are considering launch of a new product because new product
development. जैसे अगर आप नित्या को दो रोटी टेस्ट करने के लिए है तो क्या टेस्ट करेगी उसको आप इडली दोगी बढ़िया टेस्ट करके बताएंगे कि आओ so that's why in sensory evaluation at least sensory panels are consumed panels even they are also trained for the product and obviously that is regional social or so up the food jo hai it is a different location mein you have a different food and people have liking for that food
actually sir history mein sir when Kellogg's entered to india mein koi Kellogg's nahi khaya because hame garam doodh mein khane ki aadat hai unhone shayad wo pura survey kiya aur shayad
wo ki person ki he is conservative वो अपने फूड हैबिट में कंजर्वेटिव है एक बंगाली मानुस कहीं भी जाएगा दुनिया में तो माचे ढोल बात जुड़ेगा हिंदुस्तानी उसको चाहिए वो ईस्टर्न
एरिया का फूड एंड इमोशन
मतलब क्या का डाल चाहिए
आई जस्ट डोंट नो दैट टेस्ट एटलस
हम लोग 15 में पढ़ते थे 15 में पढ़ते तो हॉस्टल में हमेशा इस पर एक्सपीरियंस के में जो लोग कहते एक ग्रुप कहता था कि नहीं उड़द का दाल बनेगा एक ग्रुप कहता था नहीं अरहर का दाल बनेगा तो दैट इज व्हाट फूड एंड इमोशन एंड लेकिन जो एक बार खाना पसंद आ गया आदमी आप जाओ एक दुकान पे रेस्टोरेंट में इवन शॉप पे इफ देयर इज अ न्यू फूड इफ यू आर अलोन यू विल नॉट बाय दैट नहीं खाओगे लेकिन क्योंकि अगर दो चार लोग साथ में हो तब शायद सिक्योरिटी रहेगी अगर हमको कुछ हो गया तो अदरवाइज कोई भी अगर जो पहले खाया है उसी को आप बाय करोगे खाना पसंद करोगे
खाएंगे
तो हमको अच्छा बुरा लगने के बाद लेकिन खाने के बाद क्या होगा हमारे सिस्टम में दैट मेजर
दैट वी डोंट नो यस
ये वी डोंट वांट टू एक्सपेरिमेंट ऑन आवरसेल्फ
दैट्स राइट यस
थैंक यू मैम आई थिंक वी विल गो टू द
गाइस नहीं है
आज इंदिरा मैम नहीं है वी आर मिसिंग हर आई थिंक वी विल गो टू द थैंक यू सेशन सो आई वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट सिद्धार्थ टू गिव द वोट ऑफ थैंक्स टू सच अ वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन सिद्धार्थ
Thank you, and thanks to all of the organizers and the team of HTL who has arranged this webinar. It was really a great opportunity. Thank you Siddharth for your nice words.
Thank you ma'am. So our next presentation we will be informing about the speaker and date, so hopefully all people will be joining us. Thank you so much ma'am. Thank you sir. So we'll be finishing tonight.
Thank you sir. Namaste.